So to use a badly drawn cartoon to illustrate direct realism, and this, of course, the metaphor of the cartoon will break down super quick, but kind of the model is this. It's almost like our consciousness, you can think of it as like a little person riding around in your mind. And they're just like looking out the portals, you know, think of the eyes as portals, and they're just looking at the objects out there. Now, of course, the metaphor blows up because then, you know, what about the little person in there that's looking at stuff, blah, blah, blah. But crudely put, the idea is basically, imagine that little person metaphorically as your consciousness, riding around in your, you know, you're riding around your body, looking through the windows that are your eyes, and what you see is literally what you get. So you are perceiving the object, and when you're not looking at the object is still there. So there's no, you know, representation in your mind of the object. You are seeing the object. What you see is what you get. And this is the view, you know, again, it's common sense, you know, realism. It's a view that people have before they get philosophy or science. So, for example, if you ask a five-year-old, you know, where's the folder, they'll point to the folder. If you ask them where's the color, they'll say out here. And that's direct realism, the sensible view that we are, what we're seeing is what we're getting. So what's the second view? What happens when you get some philosophy or some science? And philosophy and science have been ruling everything since around 600 BC. Now, pretty much the standard view in science is what's called representationalism. And here's the idea, drawn with a badly drawn cartoon, how that works. So for representationalism, the idea is this. Here's the contents of a person's mind, not drawn to actual scale. And put some eyes on there, a little smile there, nose. Maybe hat. No, that's not really necessary. So what happens basically is this. What you are perceiving, according to the representationalist, is this. You have a, what they call in a fancy term, a sense datum, or a sense impression, and that's in your mind. So, if we take the example of the rabbit. Now, in this case, what the representational this would say is this. The idea that you have of the rapper is a mental entity in your mind. Now, out in the external world, outside of your mind, they would say there is this rapper, this physical object out in the world. And the physical object somehow causes, through like a physical process, possibly through like a metaphysical process as well, causes you to have that idea of it. So you've got a couple things going on. Namely, you've got out in the world, supposedly, the actual wrapper, a physical three-dimensional object existing for real, and in your mind is this representation, this image, this idea, this concept of the wrapper. So you get two things occurring. No wonder the naive or direct realism, there's just the wrapper. There's no your idea of it and the object, there's just the object. There's no dual reality. Now, this of course creates a bit of a problem because, again, you got two things going on. You got what's in your mind, and then you've got, by hypothesis, something out there in the external world. Now, we already saw the skeptical problem, because the skeptic says, aha, how do you know that what's in here matches what's out there? You're going back to the kind of, you know, Black Mirror scenario. Imagine, you know, somebody wakes up in a room full of monitors and their memories, you know, their memory's been erased, and they're looking at the monitors and a voice comes booming over the speakers, which one of these, you know, scenes is real, happening for real outside. Well, the person would have no way of knowing. because if they look around the monitors, any one of them could be computer generated. It could be, it could have been real at one point, but it's just a, you know, playing a recorded video at this point, and you have no way of knowing. Unless you can get outside of the room, you can't tell that what you're perceiving is really out there. Now, in the case of all in mind, we can never get outside of our mind. And so this is what really gets the problem of the external world going. Because you could have all the stuff going on in your mind and have nothing out there. Or it could be the Matrix, or it could be an evil demon, or maybe a not so evil demon, maybe just kind of mildly bad demon. So common sense tells us this. With our five senses, we directly perceive the world. So there's, you know, not like the separate perception in reality. And on this view, the problem of the external world doesn't even occur, because the view is that the physical world exists out there whether we're looking at it or not. So what we perceive is what there is. And of course, as we mentioned, this is what common sense tells us. Before people get exposed to the corrupting influence of philosophy or science, this is what people tend to believe. Now, as our good dead friend Bertrand Russell, who's not like super dead, but quite dead, what happens is basically this. Science, as I've sort of been, you know, clearly implying, tells us that what's going on in here doesn't match what's supposedly out there. And, sort of ironically, it casts down on the common sense view. And our good dead friend Bertrand Russell made this argument. Naive realism, you know, what we kind of start with, leads us to physics. And what he probably should have also said is, you know, biology as well. But once you get to the science, science shows that if it's true, that naive realism is false. So he creates this potentially clever paradox for common sense naive realism. Namely that if it's true, it's false. And of course, if it's false, it's false. So for the most part, naive realism, even though it avoids the problem of the external world completely, it's typically rejected because science, you know, shows that it can't be true. So what does science tell us? Well, one thing is, of course, that what we seem to be seeing is not what's really out there. As I say in conspiracy, you know, stories, nothing is as it appears. I mean, one example is this. Right now, you're looking into the past. You're seeing me not as how I am, but how I was. And likewise for everything else. Like when you look over there at the building, you're gazing into the past. And it's not any, you know, magic or any sci-fi stuff. It's just that light, as we now know, takes time to travel. And one kind of interesting, if, you know, kind of terrifying implication of this is the sun could have gone out right now. And we wouldn't know it for a few minutes, because it takes time for the light to get here. So we could all be doomed in a few minutes. Hopefully not, though. Also, as we'll see when you go through the stuff, color. You know, again, let's give the example of like, we're talking to a 5-year-old, and you say, where's the folder? They'll point to the folder. And you say, where's the color? They'll point to the color. But of course, science tells us the color's not out there in the world. Color's in your mind. It's, you know, the simple side of the explanation is it's how they reflect light, and also it's the light bounces off it, hits your retina, and causes some stuff to go off in the mind or brain. And we know this, of course, because people who are colorblind, you know, they don't see the same colors as other people. And we know, of course, that in certain physiological conditions, such as sort of diseases like jaundice,
can affect color vision.
So science tells us, that part of science, tells us that the sound that we hear isn't what's out there. The flavors we seem to taste are not out there. The things we seem to touch are not out there. What we seem to smell is not there either. So what we have basically is, you know, these, well, if you ever had, you know, basic biology or anatomophysiology, you know the basics of it. You know, you get objects out there, light hits it, bounces off, hits the eye, the retina, travels down the optic nerve to the visual center of the brain, and you have, you know, you see stuff. And then similar story for hearing things, seeing things, etc. And so, science seems to give us representationalism, the idea that there's something out there that's causing what we perceive, but it's not the same thing. Or so science claims. So the world makes us see things and hear things and, you know, touch things, but it's not, what we're experiencing is not the same. Now, one person we'll look at in some detail is our good dead friend John Locke. 1632, died in 1704, and is of course still dead today. So what does Locke contribute to the theory of knowledge? Well, first thing is this, and we'll see more about this in part three. He is critical of innate ideas, and he claims that whatever we know about anything ultimately has to be traced back to sense experience, that we don't have innate ideas. And as we'll see, he advances the now famous phrase, tabula rasa. He also held, because he's dead, to a causal theory of perception that, again, I mean, his view back in the time period when Locke was Lockean wasn't as complex as ours today because the science, you know, wasn't as good, but basically the same sort of, you know, thing. Object out there, physiological event, you get the idea. And then you have mental events. And that's kind of the stock thing in the sciences. If you take a science class on perception, that's pretty much, you know, with many more details and, you know, diagrams, that's a story you'll get. So for Locke, how does this all work? And as you can see, no expenses were spared for this fine high-quality graphic, finest Microsoft stuff. I'm anticipating an Oscar for best special effects in the classroom, I guess. I could work my acceptance speech. So how does it work? Well, basically, in this flowcharty thing. So as Locke saw it, you get stuff out in the real world. You know, we take an example of, once again, the wrapper. So you got the wrapper, and photons are flying off the light from, you know, coming off the sun, striking it, and flying into your eyes. Fortunately, it doesn't hurt. So we have the energy coming to our senses. Then we have the senses doing their thing, and we have the transformation from the physical event to the mental event, assuming there is, you know, a mind. Then if something happens in the brain, assuming you've got one, you get the perceptual experience, and then you get the result being that precept. So basically the process is that. You see the wrapper, you know, photons hit it, fly into your eye, trigger your sense organs, signals to the brain event, you know, mental event, perception, and then you have the idea form of that experience. And that's basically Locke's model. Again, that's pretty much the standard scientific model today. Now, something we mentioned previously, but it's something that's going to infest the entire class, is this primary secondary quality distinction. And the distinction, once again, is this. They were developed first by Galileo, then later thinkers like Locke and Descartes grabbed hold of them and developed them more and kept them going. So we have two sets of qualities, primary and secondary. the primary qualities are what we call the real qualities for real. So they're out there in the physical world. Standard examples, if you talk to philosophers who believe in these things, they would give the usual suspects. Solidity, you know, being solid. Extension, you know, being three-dimensional. You know, figure, movement, rest, number, all that stuff. Now, for the people who believe in the primary qualities, these would be the foundation of knowledge, because your idea of, say, the extension of an object can be really about the extension of that object. Now, one metaphor you can use for primary qualities is this. Have you ever seen, like, old video games from the 1980s, or maybe, you know, sort of like intentionally, you know, maybe like ironically simple video games where they display things just in what's called a wireframe? Or have you ever used rendering software? Like, have you ever used Google SketchUp or something? Like, when you're working with, sort of the simplest way to work with them is just wireframe. You just have the outlines and, you know, no shading or textures. And one way to think of it metaphorically is reality is kind of like wireframe. That there's no colors out there, there's no, you know, taste, etc. And so the real world is like that, you know, simple 1980s arcade game, like Asteroids or Battlezone or something. Just all these shapes and volumes and motion and stuff with no color. Now, sticking with the, you know, 3D game metaphor, obviously playing, you know, except for the retro feel, the playing a game with like that, those simple wireframes, yeah, probably not going to be a lot, you know, too exciting once you get over the old nostalgia thing, if you have any nostalgia for it. So the secondary qualities, sticking with the metaphor, would be like all the stuff you put on top of the wireframes to make it seem, you know, like a, what we call a real experience. So all the colors and so forth. And of course, in our, what we think of our real reality, we put in the smells and warmths and cools and all of those secondary qualities. So that's all the stuff we experience. Now, for Locke and other people believe in secondary qualities, those things aren't in the thing. So again, going back to my wireframe metaphor, if you could somehow magically or see the world as it truly is, if that would even be possible, again, you can think of it metaphorically as being like this, these wireframes, just, you know, geometric structures with no color, no smell, nothing, just all, you know, shapes and you know, physical, purely physical qualities. But these things, the objects out there, affect us. So they cause us to experience colors, sounds, smells, taste, touch, and other sensations. So, to give a couple examples. A good example would be sound. There is no, you know, everyone's heard the classic riddle or joke or question, a tree falls in the forest and there's no one there to hear it. It doesn't make a sound. And the answer is no. Because what would occur, of course, is, you know, vibrations. So, you know, suppose we have our imaginary wireframe world, and we have, you know, two wireframe objects, and they collide. And of course, what they would do is they would send, assuming they're, you know, in air, they would send out vibrations. And there would be vibrations, whether we're there or not. But in order for there to be actual sound, there'd have to be something there to, you know, receive those vibrations and interpret them as sounds. To use another metaphor, right now, of course, there's all kinds of, in a way it's kind of frightening, because right now there's all kinds of radiation just blasting through us, like radio. Every radio station you could get in this room, that's shooting through us right now. The Wi-Fi is, you know, going through us. But do we notice that? No, because we don't have radio receivers built in. Unless the CIA put one in.
Sometimes they do that apparently.
Yeah, so to us, we're totally blind to it. We need a radio to receive that. So it transmits the radiation to a vibration we can hear. And so without something to intercept those vibrations, there is no sound. And of course, the color, there's no color there. There'd just be light, you know, when you reflect off of it. You need something to receive that light and interpret it. So you got, as people would say today, there's all kinds of potential information out there, just like the radio waves, you know, shooting through us. But unless you have something that can receive and interpret it, there is none of that secondary stuff. No color, sound, smells, taste, etc. Final example, flavor. I think this cereal is still made. The cereal called Kix, is that still a thing? K-I-X? Maybe it's still a thing. But when I was in grad school, I mean, they had a commercial for it called, and one of the lines in the commercial was, the taste is in the shape. And I don't know if the person who did the commercial was like a philosophy grad or something, but that's basically this idea, that when you eat a cereal or bagel or pizza or anything, there's no flavor in it. So in a way, when they say there are natural flavors in something, they're lying. Because there's actually no flavor in things, it's the shape. Literally the taste is in the shape. And you can alter, the way you alter the flavor of food is by changing the shape of it, altering it molecularly. I mean, a good example of this is as follows. Anybody ever eaten a raw egg? Don't recommend it. But it tastes, I've not done it either, because I understand, you know, bacteria. But a raw egg, does it taste the same as a cooked egg? Not quite different. Similarly, like, you like a raw vegetable, things are safe to you. Like raw carrot tastes differently than cooked. And the change is, you know, you don't add any like spices or anything to it. It basically changes the structure of the proteins. Literally, the taste is in the shape. And you can produce flavors in us by altering the shapes of things, which is why, you know, one way you could have things that taste like things with no calories is it's just all shape. You don't have to actually put like sugar and stuff in there. So, on this view, again, using my metaphor, we're like in a wireframe reality, and if you could somehow perceive it as it truly is, which in a way would be impossible, you would see none of those secondary qualities. But we're basically like the radios, we're like the receivers, and we interpret, you know, the wavelengths of light as color. We interpret the vibrations as sound. We interpret, and smell. The way smell works, this is actually pretty gross, especially with like disgusting smells. The way we smell stuff, we're in a way we're kind of tasting the thing. Because there's little particles, whatever we're smelling, which actually physically contact our nose. So if you smell something terrible, this is horrible to think about, it's actually particles that are actually landing in your nose. And back in the Middle Ages, people thought that bad smells could cause disease, which in a way wasn't entirely stupid, because if you are getting particles from a thing and you're breathing them in, you know, it could come with some nasty stuff. But in general, though, the bad smell doesn't bring along with it the bacteria and stuff, unless you get really close. So all the stuff that's out there is primary qualities, and what we experience are these secondary qualities. Now, this, of course, is the view of the representationist. Now, one implication, of course, of this view, as we'll see, is, I mentioned, is this problem of the external world. Namely, how do you know there's really that world out there? And I've been talking about this, you know, metaphorically speaking, this wireframe reality out there. And a good question is how could you ever tell? You know, going back to the example of being in the story of being in the room with all the monitors, how do you know what's really going on for real? And the answer is, you can't. And that's a problem with the external world. How do you know what you're experiencing is really real? Now, one intriguing solution to this was put forth by people known as phenomenologists. And sort of the supreme phenomenologist is a guy named George Berkeley. He was English, writing about the same time as John Locke. He's considered one of the big three British empiricists: Locke, Berkeley, and Hume. And there are a lot of British empiricists. Maybe it's something, maybe like the food and the beer over there makes people empiricists. The French and Germans tend to be rationalists. Maybe if you have better food, you're a rationalist. If you have worse food, you're empiricist. You know, British food versus French and German. Now, the problem with representationalism, of course, is that problem. The claim is there's something out there, but you don't know. Actually, as we'll see when we get to Descartes, you don't even know if you've got a body. Maybe you're just a mind all by itself with all this stuff in it. So Berkeley came along, 1685, died in 1753, still dead today. He advanced something that he called immaterialism, which now people call phenomenalism. And it's the idea, you know, it's the third view. So as we saw, you know, view one is what you see is what you get. Your perception and the object are the same thing. Representational realism, what you see is what you see, and something out there is causing it, so there's two things. And the phenomenologist says, well, there's no thing out there, all the things are, and you haven't got a body, all the things are in your mind. Now, that of course is the problem of the external world. You know, the question is, how do you know there's any stuff out there? And the phenomenologist basically says, I've solved this problem. There's nothing out there. It's all in your mind. There is no external world. Which is a clever way of solving, because they have solved the problem. There is no word. There is no problem. Or in a way, you could put it as kind of a reversal of the problem, because the representational realist says, there's stuff out there. And the skeptic says, how do you know? And the phenomenologist says, there's nothing out there. Now, a skeptic could say, how do you know? Which would be kind of ironic. Now, a good question would be is, so how do you end up in that place? Well, Berkeley writes a lot of stuff about it, but we can grind down his arguments to bits. It all comes down to that primary-secondary distinction thing. Berkeley claims that distinction is BS. Why? Well, basically he argues at great length that idea that there are really qualities and objects for real out there, and the secondary qualities that are in our head, we can't maintain that distinction. In other words, as he puts it, we can't prove that there are qualities out there in the world. You know, bulk, mass, density, volume, etc. And he claims that those are all just ideas too. So those are all in your head as well. Second, he claims, through various arguments, that you can't show that our perceptions resemble other objects, that ideas can only be like other ideas. Now, the third thing he did was this. He went after this key notion of what's called substance, or stuff, specifically material substance. Here's the idea. We'll see more of this later on. And it's a metaphysical idea. Philosophers hit an idea that's got to be substance. What substance? Well, there's a quick answer, and a quick argument for it. Now, we can take the example of this exciting folder. Now, we can encounter, of course, objects like this folder, you know, blue, rectangular, solidish. But could I somehow reach into the folder and pull out the pure blue, and have a handful of blue? Not blue plastic, not blue water, but pure blue. No, I couldn't do that. Can I reach in and pull out the rectangularity, the pure rectangle? No, can't do any of that stuff. So one thing we notice is that you can have objects kind of, you know, hanging out that are blue, rectangular, etc., but you never encounter just
pure blue by itself. You never encounter rectangle by itself or mass by itself. And what philosophers somewhat reluctantly said is, well, there's got to be substances. What's a substance? Well, for philosophers, substance is what's under all the properties. It is what they are supported by in one metaphor, or kind of stuck to in another metaphor. They're whatever it is that binds all the stuff together. And again, the reason why they accept it is, and typically reluctantly, is because we don't find qualities, properties, drifting around on their own. They're always connected into coherent objects. And the thing that coheres them is that mysterious substance. Now, one of the big problems about substance, and this has been, this is something Berkeley went after, is that, well, we can use it as an example. If I were able to pull away the blue and the rectangularity and the mass, density, volume, and every quality of the folder, what would I be left with? It seemed to be
a shapeless thing.
Yeah, it seemed to be nothing. I seemed to have nothing at all. Maybe like, you know, be like, or use an example like with food. You take away all the, you know, nutrients, all the flavor, all, you know, all the ingredients, and took away the box, it would seem you'd have nothing, a whole bunch of nothing. And so the standard criticism of substance is, if you take away all the qualities, it would seem you're left with nothing, with zero. And that can't be a thing. It's what's called in metaphysics, they called it somewhat derisively, the bare particular. It's something because it's bare because it has no qualities. And so people said that's pretty weird and mysterious. If it's got no qualities, it's nothing. But they're also kind of stuck with it. So Locke reluctantly accepted substance. Descartes embraced it wholeheartedly. Berkeley, though, went after the notion of material substance. Why? Well, because he claimed that, the reason why his motivation was this, he claimed that accepting matter led to, you know, skepticism about religion, and that led to atheism. So he believed that accepting matter was a gateway to materialism, which was the gateway to atheism. And so he wanted to get rid of matter. And so he argues that there is no matter. But he did accept that there is mind. Although his criticism of matter had some unintended consequences, namely that it would seem to also attack the notion of immaterial substance. And philosophers generally broke substance into two categories. The mental, ghosty stuff, and the material, makes up like the body and objects. So as we'll see, like another kind of classic division among philosophers is there are some who believe that there is physical stuff and mental stuff, and they're called dualists. Dual as in two, as opposed to, you know, pistols or swords at dawn. Those who don't believe in any mental stuff, they're called materialists. And those who don't believe in any physical stuff, they're called immaterialists or phenomenologists. And they believe there's no matter. Now there's also the view, and we'll see this when we talk more about David Hume, the rejection of all substance, and just saying there's no substance at all. Now, so Berkeley, what he does in terms of criticizing our good man friend Locke and representational realism is this. He says that if you accept that view, that you've got an object out there, and you have an idea of the object, that leads to skepticism. Because as we saw, the question arises, how do you know that what's out there matches what's in here? The answer is, you don't. So skepticism. And Berkeley's solution is, well, let's just get rid of that out there, and problem is solved. Before pressing on to our next exciting slide, anything about that that needs more stuff? Now, after Berkeley came some more philosophers. And these people are famous philosophers, which means they're not famous at all. For example, one was A.W.T. Stace, 1886 to 1967. He basically made the argument for phenomenology that our belief that the world has got material objects behind what we perceive is unjustified. And so he advanced what's called basically a form of instrumentality, the idea being that we shouldn't accept science literally, but as a practical thing. Berkeley also ran the problem of, you know, if we reject all this matter, how do we do science? And his answer was basically a practical one, that God creates, you know, uses these ideas and stuff to create a world that's as if we had a physical world. C.H. Whiteley, 1911, I think he's dead now, I need to update that. He was also critical of the phenomenalist position. So some of this still gets debated to this day. So at this point we get three main camps when it comes to what's out there. Direct realism, which solves the problem by saying, hey, there is no gap. What you see is what you get. There's a physical world. You don't have any ideas, there's just the physical world. What you see is what you get. There's a representational realist who says, there's a world, there's your ideas, and these are two separate things. So, problem. Then the phenomenologist says, there's just your ideas, there is no external world, there is no problem. So the problem arises if you're a representationalist, because you have to find a way to say how what's in here matches what's out there. If you want to accept naive realism, no problem. If you want to be a phenomenologist, that leads to all kinds of craziness, but it does avoid the problem of the external world. Now, phenomenology does run into some problems. Now, later on, after people like Berkeley, there was the rise of what are called sense data theories. The idea being that what's in your mind, if you got one, is a brain, depending on your view about how that all works, is a piece of sense data. And so this would be, you know, representational realism. It could also be for phenomenalism as well. And they bring up these two problems. First problem is this. It's called the problem of the non-transitivity of perception. Now, I actually tried to make this work, but I couldn't make it work for myself. But here's how it supposedly goes. Suppose you have three pieces of colored, red colored paper. And suppose A and B are so similar, you can't tell them apart. And then suppose B and C are also so close, you can't tell them apart. But suppose that you can tell A from C. Now, if we go with this sense data view, the what we perceive as the sense data, this is puzzling because we should be able to tell the difference. They should be different by hypothesis. Now again, one practical problem with this is I did try using Photoshop to try to get three reds where I could tell two of them apart, but then I couldn't tell, I tried to get it so there were two reds I couldn't tell apart, A and B and C, but then I could tell A from C. And maybe it's just my inability to Photoshop properly, but I couldn't make that happen. I could always tell the difference. But maybe it did work. And I did check on the webs to see if anybody worked out, the actual colors that work, and alas, they're not finding. But in theory, this could be a problem. Now the second problem, which in a way seems kind of equally as weird as this problem, it's the puzzle of indeterminateness.
Suppose we see a speckled hen. How many speckles does our sense datum hold? And here's the problem. If we say the number is indeterminate, we seem to have a paradox between the indeterminate sense datum and the determined objects that are supposed to be represented. And so these are advanced as two problems for, you know, theories in which we have sense data. And people wrote a lot of papers about them, and they eventually died. And then people stopped worrying about the problem. Bertrand Russell, born in 1872, died in 1970, still dead today. Now, what he tried to do is take Locke's theory, which we'll see more of that later, and try to defend it. Basically, try to, you know, sort of upgrade it or update it to match the science of his time. And essentially, he basically just takes Locke's theory again and updates it with today's science. And so the idea is this. How do we know there's stuff out there? Well, his argument is this. We infer there's stuff out there because we have stuff going on in our brain. And this is basically, you know, just simply taking Locke's, also in a way Descartes' idea, that you got stuff going on in here, so there has to be stuff out there. Now, Russell does consider that voice processor is like busted or something. He says it's not impossible, but he thinks that it's an implausible view. He views like, you know, Berkeley. Now, heading into the 20th century, or deeper into the 20th century, there was another famous philosopher, and again, being a famous philosopher is very much like being famous at the Olympic sport of curling, or the Olympic sport of luging. Anybody know what luging is? Basically, like, you're on like a sled kind of thing without any protection, because bobsledding, at least you got like some bobsled around you, between you and like walls. The luging is basically, you ever seen like the, you know, kind of the kids' sleds, you know, the ones that have no protection whatsoever, it's like a wooden sled on the runners, kind of a classic sled. It's kind of like that, except it's got like, you know, more advanced. And I think they go like 90 to 100 miles an hour with like just you exposed. It's an Olympic sport, you just race down this thing. And one of the bronze medalists, the last winter Olympic, was American. And the only reason I know about this is because it was on their interview on NPR this month. And so being the most famous loser in the world means you're not particularly famous. Anybody know who she is, her name? Nope, I can't remember. I listened to the thing and I can't remember. I know she got the bronze medal and is competing again. That's all I remember. Yeah, so being a famous philosopher is like that. No one knows who you are. Now, John Searle, pretty famous philosopher. And what he tries to do is, interestingly enough, is defend direct realism, which seems like an impossible task. And you might suspect maybe this was the result of a bet or losing a bet. I bet you can't defend that. So what he does is this. He says that beliefs and perceptions are similar. They're both intentional in structure. Now, intentional in this case doesn't mean that they're like on purpose. Because one important concept in philosophy is this, that notion of intention. And philosophers came up with this idea of what's called intentionality. Now, again, unfortunately, people, you know, we only get so many words, and people insist on giving like words all kinds of different meanings, or, you know, which is confusing. Although I guess if we went with just like one word, one meaning, we have too many words. But in this case, it means this. Intentionality, philosophically speaking, is what's called aboutness. That our beliefs are about something, and that our perceptions are about something. For example, if you believe that there are unicorns, your belief is about unicorns. It's got a content to it. So one way to kind of put it crudely is intentionality is ideas can be about things without being the
To give an example, can you have an idea of a mountain? Can that be done? Yeah, boom, done. Now, is your idea of a mountain itself a mountain?
No.
No, which is good. Because it
would and, you know, be like, blow someone's head up. That'd be horrible. Yeah, so we have ideas that are about things without being the thing. Now, Searle points out that beliefs are about things, perceptions are about things. And so he claims that perception somehow gives us direct access to physical objects by being about them. And what he does is, through that clever, maneuver, he tries to show that perception is like other states that are about things, like belief, desire, memory. And he tries to beat the classic problem of the problem of illusion, which is this. An illusion is what? Well, if you see an illusion, what do you see?
It's something that appears to be real.
Yeah, it seems to be real, but is not. And what Searle tries to do is he tries to solve that problem, because if you accept direct realism, then it would seem that you couldn't have illusions because everything would be real. The whole problem of perceptual illusions would seem to be not be a problem. But Searle thinks that he works it out. And of course his critics think that he is not. I'm not sure if Searle is still alive.
I need that app I talked about, which is like alive or not alive, to check on people.
Now another famous philosopher, which you've never heard of, is Charles Lanzmann. What he tried to do is defend representationalism. And basically what he does is this. He claims, going along with the primary-secondary distinction, that nothing in the world exemplifies color. And as we believe from science, basically the standard, perception 101, you get energy, photons, in the case of light, hitting an object, hit our eyes, head through the optic nerve, and boom, we have perceived in our mind color. And he claims that this is basically kind of an evolutionary argument, that these serve a biological function, enabling us to make finer distinctions in the world. Now, jumping ahead to more recent times, like today, similar arguments are given for things like bees. Bees, like when you look at flowers, we see like, color. But bees see in, I think it's ultraviolet. So they can see different patterns on the flowers. And the argument basically is they can do that because, natural selection. Bees that could like see the patterns on the flowers better didn't die. And likewise, our ability to seemingly see color enabled us to not die, or so the argument goes. And so color is not a feature of the world or our mind. And I'm not sure if he's still alive or not. I can check on that. Okay, so that's kind of the state of the history of the problem, beginning with the origin of the problem itself, and then up until like kind of the current approach today is a lot of evolutionary theory. And then what we'll do is we'll head back and look at, in some detail, substantive writings on this particular problem. Now, when it comes to the problem of the external world, our main guy is, of course, René Descartes. Born in 1596, died in 1650, and of course he is still dead today. And this is what he looked like. Supposing. Now, Descartes, when he was Descartes, he ended up joining the army, traveling around the world, meeting people, shooting them. And what sort of set him off on this philosophical journey was, while he was staying the winter in an inn, he had a series of vivid dreams which gave him his mission, which was to solve all the problems of philosophy
using basically a mathematical approach. Now, he wrote a lot of stuff, pretty productive guy. His best-known works include The Discourse on the Method, and his very best-known work, of course, is The Meditations on First Philosophy, which we'll look at, that secured his claim to philosophical fame. So how did he end up dying? Well, this is what killed him. He got what he thought was his dream job. Back during this time period, philosophers typically tried to get jobs with various courts and royalty and so forth. And back then, if you wanted to be a court note, you'd have to have a philosopher to be your, you know, in your court to say wise things. And so Descartes was hired by Queen Christina of Sweden. He thought, hey, I got a mate. But Sweden, as he said, is a land of ice and bears. And the queen liked to get up at super early and have her lessons at 5 a.m. And so Descartes, getting up super early in the cold, caught pneumonia and died. Which imports a very important lesson. Do not go someplace cold, and do not get up too early, or you will die. Just basic science. So before he died of pneumonia, what was Descartes' motivation? Well, his motivation is very similar to many of the thinkers during the time period Descartes was Descarting, which is known by the term of the modern era. Which, of course, is kind of an unfortunate use of the term, because you think of modern as being now, but it also means the time period after the Middle Ages, but before postmodern, and postmodern, of course, is now. I guess eventually it will be post-postmodern, and then things will get even stupider. But anyways. So his motivation was this. Descartes looked at the state of philosophy and science and said, people have been talking about this stuff for thousands of years now, and nothing is settled. Everything is in confusion. And so one of his motivations was to address that confusion. And his solution, his proposed solution, was to find absolute certainty. So that was his objective. So motivation essentially is everything is confusion, everything is chaos. In many respects, this is a repeat of what we saw when we talked about the sophists. When the sophists were sophisting, or whatever they would be doing, it was a time of, you know, skepticism, everything was in doubt, all these philosophers were saying all this stuff, and there was no certainty. And here we see Descartes, you know, almost 2,000 years later, saying the same thing. Now, Descartes uses the metaphor of travel. Now, he traveled, you know, in the real world, there's such a thing, and he decides that he's going to engage on an inner journey to find the answer within himself in order to solve this problem. So one main thing he contributed, among other things, to philosophy is this. One thing is that philosophy for him is an inward journey, as opposed to citing authorities, external authorities, and going with what they say. He believes that people could find within them the authority of, you know, reason. So, using a metaphor in a way, even though Descartes himself is a devout Catholic, he started, in a way, he sort of converts philosophy to a form of sort of like Protestantism. If you're familiar with, you know, Catholicism and Protestantism, oversimplifying things in Catholicism, the idea is the church has to be the one that mediates between people and God. And so basically, there has to be an authority. And Protestantism had the idea that everyone could have a direct relation with God. And so in some ways, Descartes sort of makes philosophy into like a, puts in a Protestant branch, in the sense that instead of having to go to the authorities and get all the answers are potentially within you. It's kind of like Kung Fu Panda. The secret was inside you all the time. Now he also, one thing he did was he wrote in the first person pronoun, which is why to this day, unlike many other fields, you can write philosophy papers in the first person pronoun. You can say, I think, I believe. And apparently that's unusual in academics, but thanks to Descartes, standard policy in philosophy. So what did he want to do? Well, he had a very modest agenda. First, he wanted to find absolute certainty for the sciences and for philosophy, so that he might build upon them and develop absolute certainty. He also wanted to reconcile the what we might call the world of science, material world of science and determinism, with the non-material world of religion and freedom. Basically reconciling science and religion. Now these two projects continue to this day. We're still looking for absolute certainty in the sciences, and also we still have the struggle or conflict between religion and science. So Descartes wanted to solve these problems, and since we still have the problems, clearly did not succeed. So how was Descartes gonna do this stuff? What was his... Well, you probably encountered Descartes before. You know, most likely in geometry. You might have heard of the Cartesian coordinate system. He's the guy that made that. And he believed that you could take the model of mathematics and apply it to philosophy. Why? Why did he want to do this? Well, one thing about math is this. How sure are you that 2 plus 2 is 4? A scale of 1 to 10. Where 10 being you're sure and 1 is, you know. Yeah, it's probably a 10. Similarly, how sure are you that triangles have 3 sides? Yeah, super sure. And so looking at mathematics, he said that stuff is, you know, certain. You can be sure about stuff. And so he figured, like people, other people like Hobbes, etc., that you could take this certainty of mathematics, and if you could get that working in philosophy, you could achieve absolute certainty. So what we decided to do is essentially use 2 methods for mathematics. One, intuition, 2, deduction. Now he's also here stealing in a way or borrowing from Plato. As we saw, we looked at Plato had his famous or infamous line, and there was one level where you just saw the truth of things, the highest level. Then the next level down, you would work things out with proofs and symbols. And Descartes is basically helping himself to those ideas. So here are the 2 processes. First is what he calls intuition, rational intuition. This is where you don't work, you don't go step by step, you don't use symbols, you just see the truth. These would be self-evident, you know, notions. So Descartes believed there were some truths that would be a priori, and we'll see more later, and certain. And they were perceived by this faculty of the mind. Now again, this goes back to Plato with that notion of just seeing the truth, and it's one of the main points of contest, battle, and dispute in epistemology, namely, can you do that? Are there truths that you just know are true? By pure reason. And Descartes said, sure, why not? So the first step is rational intuition. Truths where you simply know they are true. Now the second thing he brings into play is deduction, deductive logic. Now you might recall from the ancient days of early the semester, if you get a deductive argument and it's valid, and you put in true stuff, what comes out the other end? Well, we put in truth into a valid argument, you get truth. Yeah, because valid argument, by definition, is valid means if all the premises are true, then the conclusion must be true. So if you have a deductive argument that's valid, and you put in true stuff, you get out a true conclusion. So what Descartes kind of dreamed of was basically the following system. The first step is you find the truths of intuition, where you just see the truth somehow. Then what you do is you take those certain truths and you put them into deductive arguments. And of course they would yield
and then you take that truth, you know, and put it into another argument, and then you get more truth. And you just keep putting it into arguments, and eventually you have all kinds of truths. To use a,
I guess a metaphor or an analogy, think of, well, imagine like a little 3D printer that could print more 3D printers. So you could have it, like it print out a printer, and then it could keep printing out printers as long as you can keep putting good stuff into them. And eventually you could just keep making more and more printers. There's actually, interesting enough, there's actually potentially a nightmare scenario developed by this guy, Von Neumann. He postulated this, what was called a Von Neumann, what we now call a Von Neumann machine, which was a machine that could self-replicate, could make more of itself. And of course, science fiction writers imagined that and thought, well, what if they got out of control and just started making everything into those machines and converted everything? But Descartes here is not envisioning like a nightmare, but he basically is envisioning like a machine, you know, mental machine deduction that would, you know, pull in truths and then generate more truths and then take those truths and keep making more truths. And the idea is, using the von Neumann, you know, metaphor, is eventually everything would be transformed into truth. You would have absolute certainty, or so we claim. Now, to this end, he wrote his philosophical tour de force, the Meditations on First Philosophy, which was a great success, so much so that people are still forced to read it today. Sadly, though, for him, it's out of copyright, so he doesn't get any more royalties.
Now, in this first Meditation of First Philosophy, as I mentioned, Descartes, like the Blues Brothers, was on a mission from God. He claimed that when he was resting over the winter, he had a series of vivid dreams, and he promised that he would solve the mysteries of philosophy using mathematics. And then he wrote the Meditations on First Philosophy. Now, he claims that these six meditations are basically 6 days of thought. Now, he actually took him years to write it, but it's a much better selling point to say, you know, 6 days of stuff rather than years of stuff. So how does the meditation go? Well, he begins by laying out his goal, which is this, which we've already seen. Descartes looks around the state of science and philosophy and sees that nothing is certain. All is confusion. And although much fine work has been done, we are no more closer to, you know, certainty than we were when we started. So that's bad. But Descartes, of course, is going to save the day. So his goal is to find absolute certainty, build a foundation of absolute certainty, and then assemble the sciences upon that. So to use a building metaphor, basically it's like this. It's like Descartes goes into a place, you know, and there's this ramshackle, you know, mansion that's been built up over the centuries, and it's kind of leaning off to the side, and it's on a foundation that is cracked, and the foundation also is built on sand. So the whole structure is ready to collapse. So Descartes looks at that and says, what a mess. And so what he's proposing to do, essentially, is bulldoze that thing, and then, as we'll see, what he wants to do is this. His method is going to be this, going with a metaphor. So the current state of science and philosophy is a ramshackle mansion built over the centuries, resting on a cracked and broken foundation built on sand. And that's ready to collapse. So Descartes basically wants to just like bulldoze it into the sea and start rebuilding. But he knows that if he just keeps building on sand, it's just going to keep on collapsing. So what he has to do, and this is his plan, is, using the building metaphor, keep bulldozing away the sand until he finds bedrock, solid and breakable bedrock, and then he can build upon that. To use another metaphor, think about like Florida. Why doesn't Florida have a lot of skyscrapers?
Because what is Florida, basically?
Lightning cat Florida.
What?
Lightning cat Florida.
One thing, yeah, because they probably get blown up. But also what? What's Florida, besides being
hot?
It's hot. But what's underneath the ground here?
Oh, under sea water.
Yeah, lots of water and sand. And if you build skyscrapers like on sand, they tend to like fall over. Yeah, why does Manhattan have skyscrapers? Why does New York have the pattern it does? Yeah, rock. That's bedrock. And so we can build skyscrapers on bedrock, but not so much on sand. Although people will try, because people will try anything.
Yeah, so in Tallahassee, you don't see a lot of basements, you don't see a lot of, you know, high-rise buildings because of that problem. So Descartes wants to do is dig down until he can find that bedrock, so then he can build a solid skyscraper of knowledge. Now, another metaphor, which is kind of similar, is, you know, that digging metaphor. So at this point, you know, again, you got the bad, you know, cracked foundation built on sand. You get a ramshackle mansion about to fall over. And Descartes basically says, push that sucker into the sea. And he's going to keep digging until he finds that bedrock, something that is, you know, we can build on. To use another metaphor, what I mentioned before is this. Suppose you're a research scientist and you want to find an unbreakable metal. Yeah, we can do like a Marvel Comic Universe, you know, scenario. You're trying to find something stronger than adamantium. How do you do that? How do you find something, whether something is the strongest metal of all?
Test it out.
Keep trying to break it. You're like, Wolverine, come over and give this thing some, you know, claw this thing for a while, see what happens. And so if you find something that can't be broken, you try all the tests on it and so forth, and you find something that cannot be broken by anything, you found the indestructible metal. So what Descartes is doing, you know, the two metaphors, he's digging for a foundation, you know, the solid bedrock, to use a skyscraper metaphor. To use the metal metaphor, he's trying to find an unbreakable metal, one that nothing can break. So in order to do this, here's his method. He's going to try to break stuff. Now, he does consider examining every belief individually, but he's aware that would not work because that would take forever. Because he would have a belief about his belief about his belief, he'd never get done. So the method is going to be this. First, he's going to take his beliefs and try to doubt them. Because again, his goal is, going back to the metaphor of breaking stuff, it's like trying to break things. You're trying to make an unbreakable metal, so you keep trying to break it until you can find one that you can't break. So he's going to take his beliefs and try to break them. Now, as I noted, if he tries to test every single belief, he'll never get done. It'll take him to infinity. So what he's going to do is go after the foundation of the beliefs. If he can show that the foundation of beliefs is, you know, flawed, they can push aside all those beliefs without considering each one individually. To use another construction or deconstruction metaphor, one way to take apart a building is, of course, you know, the old-fashioned way. You know, take a wrecking ball and just, you know, break it piece by piece. That takes a long time. Kind of the cooler modern version is what?
Controlled demolition.
Yeah, controlled demolition. Take out the structural supports and the whole thing just goes boom. And so Descartes is trying to do a controlled demolition of his beliefs. You take out the structural supports, and if those go, you don't have to go after each brick individually, the whole thing collapses. Now Descartes is going to do extreme testing. So his approach is, again, first, try to doubt. Second, not doubting everything individually, but doing it, you know, based on the foundation. So going after them, you know, in a group. Thirdly, there's his standard of doubt. Now Descartes, as a matter of philosophical approach, he wants to find unbreakable beliefs. So what he's going to do is adopt an incredibly high standard, namely this. If he can find in a belief even the slightest bit of doubt, he's going to reject it as if it was manifestly false. Now,
it's important to note that he's not doing this for craft or life. So he didn't go through life saying, you know, I doubt whether this I've got a sandwich or not, or I doubt this and doubt that. This is a method to find absolute certainty. So as his method of philosophical investigation, again, he's testing for destruction. If they believe can be broken, it's up. With the ultimate goal of finding the unbreakable belief. And so next time we'll see he breaks the senses and then breaks pretty much everything. So have a good rest of the day, and next time we'll break some stuff.